Glory be to Jesus. Welcome to St. Michael's this evening as we prepare to celebrate the Lenten Liturgy of the Pre-Sanctified Gifts on this sixth Wednesday of the Lenten season. It is the final week of Lent for us. Holy Week will begin on Lazarus Saturday, and we follow with the services. We ask you to join us in the prayer this evening. We thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Constantinople, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Amen. Thank you. Pre-sanctified things are for the holy.
gather this evening in this church to celebrate this beautiful Lenten liturgy of Pre-Sanctified Gifts. Within our walls are two or three people. Yet as Bishop Gregory, Bishop Paul and Gregory reminded us when he first visited us several years ago, though it might seem empty, the church is never empty. He said it's filled with apostles and angels, and saints. The Lord has promised to always be with us. Mother of God. And I say this to remind you that in the situation you find yourselves in, especially in the isolation, the lock-ins, if you will, of where we see 24/7 familiar faces, but not the rest of the people who are part of our wider circle. And when sometimes in the midst we tend to feel alone, we really are never alone. Not at all. One of those is with us. Mary, whose feast we celebrate yesterday for Annunciation, is for us a model of suffering and of faith and of perseverance. Someone who is our guide. You know, if you've ever gone through a real hardship, sometimes you know folks, maybe you're among them, who've been involved in AA. You're aware of the fact that perhaps the most benefit for all the counselors are people who themselves have gone through such crises. Or if you're suffering with some horrific illness, say it's a cancer, a particular cancer, and there's a friend or a neighbor or someone you know who comes to talk to you and says, you know, I had this. I know where you're at. I went through it. I'm going to be with you. I will stand by you. I'll pray with you. You'll find strength in that and solidarity. I mention these things because we celebrated the Feast of Mary yesterday. You need to remember. She is someone and her life teaches us how to persevere in this. We sing all kinds of hymns of praise to the Mother of God. We're honorable to the cherubim, glorious in the seraphim. All these beautiful hymns we have, devotions of Mary, but we sometimes tend to forget that she knew both sides of the coin of incredible joy and incredible hardship, too. She's a one young woman about to be married to Joseph. An angel comes to tell her a message that God has something in store for her. She will become with a child and will be the savior of the world. He says without faith, on the handmaid of God, let it be. But the truth of the matter is that in that day and age, to be with a child and not be married was a real difficulty, to say the least. It would become an outcast. But in her pregnancy, goes to visit her cousin Elizabeth. The reprieve, beautiful prayer, my soul magnifies the Lord, my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. When she's near the end of that pregnancy, we're aware of the fact, we read the story at Christmas time, how an edict came from Caesar Augustus, and they traveled from Nazareth to Bethlehem. That's not like a walk in the park. You've been to the Holy Land. It's some distance. Try walking or riding a donkey if you're with a child near the end of the pregnancy. And yet, they persist. We find in the story of the Nativity, when they arrive in Bethlehem, eager, looking for some place of solace and peace. There's no room for them in an inn. They find a cave, warmed by the breath of animals. And there, the King of Glory enters the world. Which is just a little tight, under two. She and Joseph are warned in dreams to flee from where they are to the land of Egypt, because Herod is out to destroy all the children under the age of 2, the males, because he's afraid of competition. Who would take his place, he thought. And so she and Joseph, the child Jesus, become refugees. Care about them. Consider the image we have in the world today of our treatment of refugees, or non-treatment. Pretty tough, say the least. And time will go on, and she sees the child grow, and we know the story. When she's 12 years old, and they go to Jerusalem, it's a pilgrimage. He enters the temple, and there he begins for 3 days to teach the scribes and teachers of the synagogue. Mary and Joseph, Dickens with others, they take leave of Jerusalem on their way home, discover he's not even there, and he's like a missing child, and she's a mother, and this child is missing. In terror, fearful, they finally find him, reunited, trauma of a mother. Along the way, as the tradition of the church reveals, she learns what it is to become a widow, the death of Joseph. It's almost Good Friday for our Catholic and Protestant friends, for us another week to go. If you look at the icon behind this altar, see the lifeless body of Jesus standing by the cross, his disciple John, and the sorrowful mother, in which David sang so beautifully before we started this evening. Hardship. Yet she is a model of faith. So much so that we gather in this church at the Paschal celebration and will sing the great hymn, "Beyond Alleluia," to the angel. Proclaim to the Lady, full of grace, rejoice, your Son is risen from the dead. And even in the book of Acts before Pentecost, we find the disciples gathered in the upper room, praying for the coming of the Spirit, the birth of the church of all of us. Mother God is with us in our hardship and model faithfulness in difficult times. So we pray, ask her, start the journey. God, pray for us. We'll conclude with a prayer of Mother God for those who are guilty. Let us pray to the Lord. Asking